said, the scope is preventing CLP attacks on bus station with linear overhead. By Rex Stefano, Peter Rasmussen, and Kamisa. Speaker is Rex Stefano.
So thanks for the introduction. So this is joint work with Peter Rasmussen and Kamisa. And so what I'm going to be talking about is how to defend obfuscation constructions against a certain type of attack. And so currently obfuscation relies on multilinear map constructions. And so in particular, in this talk, I'm going to be talking about defending obfuscation against a particular exploiting the CLP version of multilinear map. So first, I guess this is going to be a slight review looking at the previous talk, but I'll just briefly introduce what obfuscation is. So the question that obfuscation answers is how do you hide a secret inside the source code of a program? So we need a security definition for this notion. And the security definition we're going to work with is the following one. So let's assume we have a procedure IO that takes a program source code as input and outputs an obfuscated version of this source code. And so basically we want this procedure to strip the program of all distinguishable features except for its functionality and its size. So what I mean by that is that let's say we have two programs that are functionally equivalent. So in other words, they behave identically on all inputs. And so we want the obfuscations of these programs to be indistinguishable. So we're going to be talking about obfuscations of a certain type of program representation called matrix branching programs. And it's known that if you can obfuscate matrix branching programs correctly, you can bootstrap that to obfuscate all polynomial size circuits. So what is a matrix branching program? You can think of it as a set of columns of matrices. And an evaluation, to sort of make sense of this, let's talk about what an evaluation of this program is. So to evaluate the program, we choose a matrix from each column based on a bit of the input. And we keep on doing this until we've chosen a matrix from every column. And then we compute the product of those chosen matrices, and this is the output of our program. So for binary programs, we can say that the output is 0 if the product is the identity, and it's 1 otherwise. So given that, the idea behind most obfuscation schemes is that it's the following. It's a two-step outline. So the first step is that we take a matrix branching program and we randomize the matrices in some way such that the products are all preserved, but the values are hidden. And then the second step is that we encode these matrix values in a way that allows evaluations of the branching program, but doesn't allow any other computation. So it turns out that a multilinear map is a really natural way to obtain the second step, because what a multilinear map does is it allows you to encrypt values over a ring or a finite field in such a way that anyone can evaluate a very restricted set of polynomials over these values. So the problem with this outline, or this strategy, is that is with the multilinear map itself. So multilinear maps, every multilinear map construction that we know of suffers from attacks. And in particular, the CLP multilinear map candidate suffers from a class of attacks called zeroizing attacks. And so these attacks are quite intricate constructions, and they they sort of rely intimately on the details of the CLT multilinear map. But we don't need, for the purpose of this talk, we don't need any of those details. All we need, so we don't need to know how the CLT multilinear map is constructed, or we don't need to know the details of the attacks. All we need to know is that they all follow a particular pattern. And this pattern is that to employ a zeroizing attack, we need three sets of encodings, A, B, and C, such that we can choose any element from each of these encodings and multiply them together and get zero. So in other words, we have this this three-wise product, and we need to be able to vary the choice for each component of the product independently of the other two choices, and still get an encoding of zero at the end. So it's sort of like a cross product of products. Okay, so applying this, so to apply these zeroizing attacks to obfuscation, we get a sort of parallel property. An interesting parallel property that sort of parallels the previous property that needs to hold over the function itself being obfuscated. So namely, we need to be able to partition the input bit indices of the function into three parts so that we can vary the choice of bits for each part independently of the other choices, and always get zero. So these zeroizing attacks originally we only knew how to apply them to a very restricted set of branching programs, but a year ago, Karan et al. Figured out how to sort of greatly expand this set of vulnerable branching programs, and so these attacks suddenly became much more threatening to I/O or CLT. And because of that, it's now quite interesting to try to defend against them. And so our goal is to do that. And the way we're going to do that is by exploiting the fact that every attack requires this property over the input bits that I described. And so we're going to call that property an input partition. And so we're going to show how to eliminate input partitions and thus secure obfuscation against zeroizing attacks. So one key point is that an input partition is not a property of a branching program, it's a property of the function that's being represented by the branching program. And so to prevent an input partition, we can actually just change the function that's being represented slightly, and that's sufficient. So we're going to attempt to do this, and we're going to do this by introducing a hash-like function h that we're going to call it an input step. And we're going to do this transformation, the following transformation. So we're going to take a function f, and we're going to produce an f prime that takes an input to f and a step y, and it's going to check whether the y is a correctly computed input step of the input, and if that's true, it's going to output the original output f. Otherwise, it's going to just output some arbitrary non-zero value. So this is note that this is constraining the ways that somebody can obtain a zero from this function, because now not only do they have to find an x such that f of x is zero, they also have to correctly compute this new h. So we're going to call this transformation securing a function f. So the main theoretical result of our paper is a necessary and sufficient condition. for a function h to successfully secure any function f, so to successfully prevent input partitions. And so for the purpose of this talk, I'm going to actually describe a simplified version of the main theorem that's a sufficient condition. So I'll refer to the paper for the full result in its full strength. So this result is a sort of non-linearity. So let's choose points x1, x2, x3, and x4, such that the difference between x1 and x2 is the same as the difference between x3 and x4. And so it is the case that h never preserves this difference equality for any choice of x1, x2, x3, and x4, then h will secure any function f. So if you find such an h, that means you have a defense against zeroizing attacks. So now our goal will be to just construct these functions h, and so. And since this is a very arithmetic property, it's natural that a lot of number theoretic functions. So you can naturally find a lot of number theoretic functions that satisfy this property. One such function is the squaring function minus some large prime b. And it's very intuitive why this might hold, because the squaring function is obviously never linear at any point. So it's very easy to show that it satisfies this non-linearity property. So the problem with number theoretic functions is that branching programs don't support arithmetic operations over their inputs naturally. And so because of that, these number theoretic functions tend to not be they tend to not be efficient. And so our last contribution is to construct a very efficient combinatorial function that secures that prevents input partitions. And how we're going to do this is we're actually going to use a probabilistic construction. So we're going to define a family of of input stamps h, and then if we choose an input stamp at random from this family, this function is going to secure all functions f with very high probability. So the idea behind this construction is just we're going to observe the behavior of a completely random matrix branching program. So let's say we have a weak ones branching program where we choose all of the matrices to be random permutation matrices. So if we fix inputs x1, x2, x3, and x4, where the differences are equal, it turns out that over the choice of a random branching program h, the probability that our nonlinearity property holds over this particular fixed set of points is non-negligible, even for a small fixed size of k, size of the permutations. And so we can use this in the following way. So there's a technique that's known in the literature to evaluate many branching programs in parallel over the CLT multilinear map. And so we're going to use this, and we're going to evaluate many independently sampled instantiations of our random branching program. And then we're going to do just we're going to use this to define a new function h, and the output of this function is just a concatenation of the outputs of all of these random matrix branching programs. And so we can use the union bound argument to show that if t is large enough, then this combined function h is nonlinear over all choices x1, x2, x3, and x4 with very high probability. So so we can do a bit of analysis to show that that this new function h can secure any function f with linear overhead, with sort of a linear log in the size of the branching program being obfuscated. So in terms of future work, Fermi Ma and Mark Zandri just posted, a month ago, a paper where they give a new weak multilinear map, or a weak model for CLT multilinear map, and they show that this multilinear map model captures all known attacks on the CLT multilinear map, including these zeroizing attacks, and they also show that the standard dual input obfuscation. The standard dual input obfuscation techniques are secure under this weak model, and so I think it would be interesting to sort of see where these two results fit together. Thank you.
So you're sort of changing f so that it only sometimes outputs the right value. So how do you know that your obfuscated circuit still has the correct response?
So
I mean, you want your program to work correctly on all inputs.
Yeah. So given f prime is always possible to obtain a computation of f, you just have to. I mean, so you take the input x that you want to compute f over, and then you just you yourself compute the hash value h, and then you plug this combined value into the f prime.
I guess I'm missing. I'm thinking of an obfuscated program. I've just got this thing that I'm running. I'm not changing the design on the fly, right?
Yep. And he's giving you more complicated to call it f prime, right? No, f on x. Then you take x, you compute h on the h, like when you plot it. And then you have this x and y, and then you plot that into your oracle, and you get it. I'm just repeating this.
Yeah, excellent. Yeah. Good teamwork.
Okay, is there any other question? Okay, let's start the speaker again.